RFC Ambrin has just released its most recent report in the mining sector, and it's titled More Ups Than Downs. Its head of research is Duncan Hughes, and he joins us now with some more. Duncan, welcome.
Thanks, Jeremy. Good
what trends are you observing as we go into 2013?
Well, we're seeing quite a few trends appear, obviously, with the current market conditions as they are. One of the main trends, obviously, is risk-averse investors. So we're seeing quite a bit of money come out of equities and go into what's perceived as more solid investments, such as gold or UK, US and German bonds. With that, we're seeing that in the equity space, if an equity underperforms, then it gets pretty severely punished. What we're also seeing is the investors are pushing more and more for dividends. In these difficult times where it's hard to get financing, there's quite a few expansion programs put on hold. Investors want to see an income stream return. Gone are the days of where you can just rely on capital growth in a share price. So income stream is great. One of the things that's really raising its head recently is a push by the economies that host the mine projects themselves, pushing for nationalisation or at least a greater domestic sort of share in the project. We've seen that in countries such as Kenya recently, talking at least of a 35% local ownership. Our friend in Zimbabwe has obviously pushed for 51% ownership, and so on and so forth. And it's not just that we're seeing the push for ownership, we're seeing changes in tax regimes and royalty regimes. Mali's talking about changing their regime. Ghana, which is perceived as one of the preferred places to invest, has lifted its tax rate recently from 25 to 35%. Burkina Faso, another one that used to be a bit of a market darling in the gold space, is talking about a new tax as well, 20% on the sale of a producing asset. So these are changes that we're certainly seeing recently. But we're also seeing the underperformance of producers. And when you combine that with risk-averse investors, well, it results in dramatic share price performance.
So you're talking there about the opportunities, presumably?
There are opportunities, for certainly. I mean, we see a lot of company share prices be smacked down a lot on the back of underperformance. Avocet is perhaps an example of that. They felt things were going quite well and looked to pay a dividend earlier on in the year, and then suddenly realised that they were underperforming, fairly drastically at Enata, put out some poor production data over a couple of quarters, explained that this is a process that they're going to do going forward to fix things up, but the market has sold them down an awful lot. The reason we're seeing a lot of this, though, is and not just specific to the companies I've just spoken about, but there's serious cost pressures out there with the fuel price, expectation of increased labour costs. The fact that we've had elevated commodity prices for some time now as part of the boom has meant that more marginal assets are now being mined. And with more marginal assets, there's more opportunity for hiccups and underperformance in production. Vatukoula, again, is an example of sporadic performance. Then when you add political unrest, which, of course, Centamin might be a good example of that in Egypt, well, there are opportunities for sure with these prices perhaps being oversold down.
What's the environment like at the moment for mergers and acquisitions? Is that mostly in the larger cap stocks, or are you seeing any more elevated M&A activity in the small cap sector?
Well, that's a very good question. It's a point we do make in our Minds and Money, but we are seeing that a lot, and I think we will see more and more. At the moment, it tends to be happening, with producers, and obviously it happens at a very large level with Glencore and Xstrata, but we're seeing other miners, other producers, not necessarily achieving the valuation they feel they deserve on the market as they are, and not receiving appropriate sort of share price appreciation from organic growth. So they are then looking to acquire. We see this with one good example of that is the likes of Endeavour Mining, which acquired Adamas, which was a developer a couple of years ago now, probably at least a year ago, and it's now looking to acquire Avion as well. It's looking to grow its production base from perhaps 100,000 ounces to 300,000 ounces, where it feels that risk-averse investors will see the value in this. They're, investors are definitely more comfortable investing in larger larger companies.
Looking down some of the stocks, I mean, you've mentioned a lot of stocks already. One sticks out for, let's say, the low-cost producers. I mean, Mandalay, you make an example of Mandalay as a good example of a low-cost producer. What is it particularly you like about Mandalay? Clearly, being low-cost is good.
Yeah, low-cost is great. And, I mean, producing at a, you know, at a equivalent silver ounce basis of $5 an ounce after gold credits from Cerro Bayo in Chile is great. But what I like about Mandalay is big company management that are bringing the, they have a strategy in place and they're acting on it. And they say that they're going to bring previously underperforming producers with strong exploration assets up and running and make them work. They've demonstrated that they've done that. And I think in these difficult markets, it's very important that you can demonstrate that you're going to do what you say you'll do. In addition, they're paying a dividend. As we've already discussed, investors really like that. And they've got projects that are in relatively low-risk environments, which obviously goes back to, you know, what we were talking about earlier as well. I mean, Chile and Australia, despite some silly moves perhaps by the government in Australia, are relatively safe environments.
What about in amongst some of the developers? One of your top picks there is Base Resources. This is a company I'm not massively familiar with.
Yeah, so Base Resources is a mineral sands developer. It's an ASX-listed developer. It produces a large amount of rutile, which is one of the higher cost end products, and on a revenue to cash cost basis is one of the most robust projects. But because Base has been in that quiet period where it's sort of it's now fully funded, but it's not pumping out exploration results. It's just quietly getting on with constructing things. So it's sort of fallen off investors' radars a little bit. Then when, again, the topic of nationalisation rears its ugly head.
Because they're in Kenya, aren't they?
Because they're in Kenya, and there was talk of a 35% local ownership in Kenya. Well, they got smacked down quite a lot on the back of that. So now that things have been resolved, they're fully financed, and it certainly appears to be the case that this 35% local ownership will not apply to Base. Even if it did, it's such a robust project that it's still undervalued. I think that, you know, they're getting into production. This is a great opportunity for underinvestment.
You mentioned a lot of the concerns about governments in Africa. What about Europe? Where does Europe stand on this now? Because I know there have been some issues about permitting, haven't there? Has the risk perceptibly changed in the last year or so in Europe?
The risk has definitely the perception has to change, and it has, and it is changing. I mean, we've talked about Africa, but it's not just Africa. I mean, Indonesia has talked about nationalisation. We've had problems in South America. We're seeing that political unrest and uncertainty can, you know, mess up the economics of a project and deter foreign investment. Europe has great infrastructure and politically is stable. There's always been this perception that, you know, getting permitting is difficult. Now, with the crisis that we're all aware of in Europe at the moment and unemployment levels as they are, I think that those barriers to permitting and the, you know, perceived, at least, and in some cases this is the case, local disinterest in the projects, to put it mildly, that's going away. So permitting we are seeing is happening. We saw one of the companies we cover, Edgewater Exploration, which is a TSX-listed junior that's looking to develop a 1.5 million ounce gold project in Galicia in northern Spain. We've seen that it's got its environmental permit through now. We've seen the share price has gone up a little on that, but there's still this perception that, you know, there's still a permitting process and a bureaucratic process to get through. I think once you see more of these projects get through, there'll be more and more investment and understanding of what's happening in Europe. EMED is another one that's listed in this country that has got a great project, the Rio Tinto mine, but it's got a long history of locals being against the project and permitting challenges. From what I understand, and EMED held a site visit recently, which I didn't attend, but one of our analysts did, it looks like permitting is not too far away. And then, you know, coming out of Spain for a minute, there's a company that I visited just a few days ago, Ortac Resources, mm-hmm. which has
this is in Slovakia, isn't
has
it?
Right, has gold project in Slovakia. Now, Slovakia does actually have a strong mining history, but during the Soviet era, where let's just say they perhaps were not quite so concerned about, you know, the environment and the needs of the locals as perhaps you would be modern day. But there is still that legacy, and Ortac have an excellent project with, you know, everything going right about it, and the expectation is that this project would generate good profit margins. But they have to win the locals over, and they then have to win the investors over to convince them that they've won the, you know, the locals over. And we all know, you know, that in Romania, for example, with Rosia Montana, that this can be a drawn-out process. But I think more and more things will start to happen.
I'm interested in a chart that you want to bring up on the screen. Can you just talk us through this as to what's happening? Because you've got here the spot gold price against the FTSE Gold Mines Index, and there's this big disparity opening up between the two. Just talk us through what this tells us.
Certainly. Well, I mean, what this first of all tells us is, in red, we're seeing the gold spot price, and we're seeing how it's reacted to political unrest or financial, you know, movements. So we see that with QE programs, when they come in, the gold price understandably shoots up as, you know, investors remove their investments from the US dollar, a weaker US dollar, into what's again perceived as stronger gold price. Now, in blue is a gold mines index, which, you know, is a good representation of gold equities. And I think what you're seeing back in 2008, you see that serious disconnect. But historically, you'll agree that you can see that equities and the gold price tend to follow each other. But there's a big disconnect where, you know, risk-averse investors have run away from equities. So it was fairly quick and sharp in 2008 because, oh dear, it was terrible. But it was well understood what was happening.
And you can overlay pretty much any stock on this part of the chart, can't you?
Yes, you can. And there was an obvious arbitrage opportunity there, wasn't there, between, well, let's buy equities and it's going to come back in line with the gold price. And it did, and people made some money on the back of investing there. Now, what we're seeing today is a much more drawn out, what I would say, arbitrage opportunity between equities and the underlying gold price, where the uncertainty in Europe, which, you know, it's less clear when everything's going to be resolved and where the light is at the end of the colour, the tunnel, has prolonged the arbitrage opportunity. But nonetheless, there will be in the future, if you take a longer term view, there is this arbitrage opportunity, and there are still some great opportunities in gold equities to make a lot more on your investment than if you're just buying gold, which you see has been relatively flat over the same period.
So in sum, where are we as we go into 2013? What do you think will be crossing your desk next year? More M&A, more company failures, more nationalisation? What do you think the trend's going to be?
Well, we're going to see all of that. I think the trend's going to continue. Unfortunately, I think we've got a little more pain, you know, a little more pain ahead of us. And what I've just spoken about, you know, in this interval will apply going forward in 2013. The uncertainty is there, but the opportunities are still there. I mean, there's certain companies at certain stages will struggle. They'll struggle if there's the political uncertainty that we talked about. They'll struggle if they're an early stage explorer that's going to need cash, because it's very hard for early stage explorers low on cash to raise that money. Having said that, there are still some great stories out there in the exploration space. One of them being Papillon Resources, which share price performance reflects the fact that, yeah, this is an explorer, but it's a great explorer with great management.
But
it's in Mali. You can't have everything, can you? But that's fine. And it would be, you know, valued significantly more so in Mali. And Mali is an interesting topic, because if you'd asked most analysts a couple of years ago how safe Mali was, everyone would say it was one of the safest opportunities there. And then it's, you know, obviously an example of things being difficult. Another explorer that I want to talk quickly about is that, just to demonstrate that if you pick the right exploration stories, you can make money on them, is one called Sirius Resources, which has just discovered a world-class nickel discovery in Australia, so a relatively safe jurisdiction. Their share price has obviously done very well, and they just managed to raise $44 million Aussie dollars in in cash. That's pretty good going for
the sport. So there are bright spots going into 2013.
There are bright spots, but you just have to be really careful about what you you invest in, and you know, dividend paying producers that do what they say they're going to do, like Mandalay, and continually reach their goals, are ones that I'd be looking for rather than ones that have a history and a track record of underperformance. Yeah. And I would be staying away from some countries like Egypt that have significant amount of risk associated with them.
Okay, well, it's a pleasure having you in, and thanks for talking us through all this, because it's a fascinating read, 117 pages of which has passed my desk in the last couple of days. Duncan, thanks indeed for joining us. Duncan Hughes there from RFC Ambrium.